Hello, and thank all of you so much for being with us here today at South by Southwest in the wonderful state of Texas. My name is Vikrant Reddy. I'm Senior Research Fellow at the Charles Koch Institute. Through research, education, and discussion, we aim to advance an understanding of how to help people improve their lives. You can read more about the Charles Koch Institute, our programs for students and for young professionals, and our public policy work at charleskochinstitute.org. I also want to tell all of you guys that there are note cards left on your chairs. There's going to be time for Q&A with the audience at the end of today's program. So if you've got a question, write it on your note card, wave your hand in the air, and people are coming around to pick them up. We're going to talk today with Weldon Angelos, who, as you saw in the videos, recording artist and producer, who got 55 years in prison in 2004 for selling a pound and a half of marijuana, but who was released after 13 years due to an unprecedented public campaign. Now, whatever you think of Weldon and his conduct in 2004, I think we can all agree with what Snoop said in the video, that that was a punishment for which the time didn't fit the crime. The injustice of the punishment was so extraordinary and captured so much attention that several of the most powerful people in American politics, American business, and American culture paid attention to it. Two of those people, both of whom are good friends of Weldon, and who are supporters of him, are joining us on stage today to reflect on his experience and to talk a bit more about the future of criminal justice in America. At the end, there is Mark Holden, who serves as Senior Vice President, General Counsel, and Corporate Secretary of Koch Industries, Inc., which Forbes estimates is the second largest privately held company in the country. Mark also serves on the board of two Koch subsidiaries, Georgia-Pacific and Molex Electronic Technologies. He earned his law degree from the Catholic University of America. He earned a bachelor's degree from the University of Massachusetts, where he earned a little bit of extra pocket money by taking a job as a prison guard for some time. Maybe we'll talk a bit about that today. Also, immediately next to me is Snoop Dogg. If you are approximately my age, I'm 36 years old, you don't need any introduction to Snoop, because for the past 25 years, his music and his voice have just been a part of the soundtrack of our lives. His voice is in some of the most iconic songs of our generation. But what I want all of you to know for today's program is that Snoop has also emerged as a significant philanthropist. He is somebody who is not only contributing money, but also his time to very important American causes. I think he's probably most proud of his Snoop Youth Football League. Over the last 4 years, 80 of the kids in the Snoop Youth Football League have gone on to Division I colleges. Many of them are the first in their family. They have Snoop to thank for that. Let's start talking. Weldon, let me just ask you what the heck happened. Under Utah law, you would have gotten like probation probably, but you get 55 years. What happened?
Well, let's see, I was 22 years old. I was working in the music industry. I was trying to get a career in the music industry, working with Tupac Outlaws and one of my good friends, Badass, who was a friend of Snoop's and Daz Dillinger. And they actually introduced me to Snoop, and I had the opportunity and the blessing to go to Snoop's house and record, I think, 4 records we recorded.
Yes, sir.
So I was, I released an album, had an album coming out, but at the same time, I wasn't balling. I still needed to pay the bills.
Yeah.
So, I was hustling. I was selling weed on the side and ended up getting set up by a confidential informant. I think I sold about $900 worth of marijuana total. Mm-hmm. And the way the prosecutor designed my indictment, it triggered a 55-year mandatory minimum sentence.
Snoop, you knew Weldon back in those days. Was he a real dangerous guy you needed to be put away for 55 years?
No, not really. I mean, like he said, he was, hustling, trying to do right. But at the same time, he had to provide, means for his family and himself. So it wasn't nothing violent. It was a transaction more or less, you know what I'm saying? It wasn't like it was a violent crime that he was committing or he was a violent person. He was just hustling.
Mark, there's a line from the judge who sentenced Weldon. He said that the sentence was cruel, unjust, and irrational. And he's the guy who had to hand down the sentence. Talk to us a bit about why we have mandatory minimums in the first place. Why don't judges like him get the discretion to do what they think is right?
Yeah, well, I mean, the good news is because of criminal justice reform that started here in Texas about 10 years ago, hopefully we're going to see less and less of mandatory minimums over time. But what happened during the war on drugs, from the 80s and 90s to the present, is we decided to treat an issue which was in many ways either a poverty issue, really a public health issue like addiction, we decided to treat it like a criminal issue. And it was based on fear and emotion, not anything to do with science and data, like the reforms that are happening now. And Congress decided, and this was bipartisan, it's important, this was both Republicans and Democrats have done this together. They decided that we would lock people up for long periods of time, regardless of the circumstances of their situation. We would not let the punishment fit the crime, by and large. And that was the public policy that we as a country followed for many years. And we're seeing a trend where that's reversing now, and we can talk about that later with all the reforms that are coming. But the reality is, in Weldon's case, if you think about it, he was selling marijuana to an undercover informant. And he did it three times. He was arrested and charged under this sentence with 55 years. But if law enforcement was worried about public safety because he had a gun on him, which he didn't use or brandish, they probably should have arrested him the first time. Because what if he had shot someone the second time? So that's one of the problems with these mandatory minimums. They're not making us safer, and they lead to perverse outcomes where the system is gamed. And I'm not blaming anybody in this process necessarily, but that's what's happened. And so what we're going back to now, more and more we're seeing, is where the punishment will fit the crime based on the individual circumstances that occurred by the person who committed the crime and what happened to the victim. And that's the right way to go. But we still have a long way to go at the federal system for that.
Weldon, I've got a friend who's a law professor in New York. His name is John Pfaff, and he just wrote this book called Locked In, which has made a big splash in these criminal justice circles. He makes a lot of arguments in the book. One of the things he says is, we don't know anything about why prosecutors make the decisions they make. It's a total black box. Do you have any idea why? Because this man had all the discretion to charge you in the way he wanted. Why did he charge you like this?
He didn't give a reason, and he didn't have to give a reason. That's the thing. Prosecutors hold all the discretion, and their decisions are unreviewable by the courts, which is why we need to give the discretion back to the judge, who is the only neutral case participant.
Snoop, it's interesting that you're here. You're a musician, and I started going through the list of all these musicians who've been so passionate about criminal justice all these years. In fact, I found this really interesting list online of musicians who have actually performed in prisons. And the most famous is Johnny Cash, Folsom Prison, everybody knows that. John Legend just played at a prison in Washington. B.B. King played the Cook County Jail in Chicago. Public Enemies performed at Rikers. What is it that draws musicians to criminal justice and this issue set?
Well, I don't know about those musicians, but me personally, I have a connection to both sides of the coin, to being incarcerated, to being, you know, wrongfully, you know, given time for something that I did. And now that I feel like I have a voice, it's my job to bring some awareness and some, you know, opportunities to people who don't get the opportunity to speak on scenarios like Weldon's scenario, because there's many more that's locked up that don't get the attention or get the push or get the support of billionaires to back them and bring their, you know, court case to America's eyes. So that's my job. I'm from the hood, so I got to go back to the hood and do certain things that, you know, keep my relationship straight with the brothers that's locked up, who are wrongfully locked up. It's not my job to get those out who are there because they're supposed to be there. But those who are not supposed to be there for that time period, I try my best to work alongside people like this to try to get some recognition and some, you know, some eyes on a scenario that's bad.
Yeah. Weldon, people who work in this space will use this term. It's called collateral consequences. What this basically means is that we all think that you go to prison, you come out, and you should just get to live your normal life again. But there are these collateral consequences, these other things that prevent you from being able to put your life back together. Are you facing any of these consequences?
Yeah, I mean, one of them is when you get out of prison, you have that felony conviction, that label, and that label stays with you forever.
Yeah.
So you go try to get a job, you're like, oh, I'm fresh out of prison. They're like, okay, see you later. They don't want to hire you. So that's one of the difficult things I've been facing.
Sure, it's like a scarlet letter.
Yeah, I mean, I came to prison, I was like 23 years old. So it was like I had a career going. I get out 37, like I have to start all over at 37?
Mark, there are probably some people out there who might be thinking, well, okay, but what about the victims? They're real victims to crimes. We have to, you know, obviously,
What victim to him selling weed? Who's the victim?
No, he's right.
Mark,
exactly. Well, yeah.
Snoop's spot on that one. No, that's the problem, though, in our system. Yeah, I mean, when someone hurt someone else, a violent crime or property crime, the victim should be compensated.
Yeah.
And it should be dealt with. Punishment should fit the crime. We've gone overboard. Like Weldon said, we've decided that we don't trust judges to make decisions, so we're going to let prosecutors to make decisions. And I don't agree with that. We have a lot of friends that are prosecutors, but it's way too much power, as Weldon said. The judge is really the only neutral person in the courtroom. You've got now prosecutors who are prosecutors, judge, juries, and executioners. But the reality is, if there have been a number of surveys, particularly recently, 3 or 4, that have talked to victims of crime and what they want out of the system. And they want shorter sentences. They want people punished, but they also want other things. They want rehabilitation and reformation. They want these people coming out of prison better than they went in. And that's important. And going from a prison system that's focused on retribution, revenge, going back to more rehabilitation, reformation, and redemption. And at the end of the day, they also want more funding for education, particularly education before people end up in the system. In our country, we spend over $250 billion a year on incarcerating people and the entire criminal justice system every year, at least that much. We spend $80 billion alone on incarcerating in this country, which is 3 to 4 times more per capita than we spend on education. So if you are what you eat, you definitely are what you spend. And that's a message we're sending here. And victims of crime, they want that fixed as well. So everybody's in agreement. People who commit violent crimes, everyone needs to be punished, but we need to have a pathway for people who come out of prison, because the only reason to have a criminal justice system, in my opinion, is to make communities safer and to give people second chances so when they come out, they don't hurt anybody again and they can have a fulfilling life.
You know, Weldon was talking about these challenges that you have just trying to get a job. One of the things that people will talk about a lot is that you have to fill out a job application and you have to check a little box that says whether or not you've ever been in prison. So there's been this initiative called Ban the Box. I think the city of Austin has passed it, and I think that Koch Industries has implemented it.
Yeah, that's.
Tell me about why you guys implemented it and what your results have been.
Well, you saw Charles on the video earlier. You didn't get to see, they cut out my rapping. I did a great job. I think Snoop was nervous, so they took it out. But we see the system as it's set up now, it's fundamentally flawed, and it needs to be fixed. And we know who goes to prison in this country and why they go to prison. And the reality is a lot of people go to prison over nothing for a long time. So knowing that, and then looking at ourselves as a global employer, We've got hundreds of thousands of employees around the country, about 120,000 around the world, about 70,000 in the U.S. We're in a global talent hunt for the best people, period. Not the best people with a criminal record or without a criminal record. And 1 in 3 adults in this country have some type of criminal record. And that has an impact on everybody, whether it's felony or misdemeanor or whatever. And if you're going to, as an employer, in our opinion, take the position that, well, anyone, 1 in 3, we're going to exclude 1/3 of the potential workforce or applicant force because they have a criminal record, that's really short-sighted. And so what we've learned over time is we've hired people, I've been with the company 22 years, who have criminal records, they can be really good employees. They're humble, they're hungry, they want a chance. Among our best employees, some of them. And then conversely, we've hired people who have the best credentials, go to all the fancy schools, great references, and they're terrible employees. They're whiny. They're entitled, and some of them have stolen from us. So for us, this whole system is out of whack from beginning to end, and this is the way we look at it is we need to give people a second chance and get to know the whole person. So rather than excluding someone from the beginning of the process, let's interview them, let's get to know them. And then down the road, we'll do a background check and see what's there. But if they're the right person for the job, that's who we want, period.
Snoop, some people probably... Well, you can applaud by all means. Some people might say something like, well, you know, Weldon, just go back to your old career, just, you know, go be a music producer again. But I would think that in 13 years, the music business has changed a lot. I mean, have things changed that would make it hard for somebody to just step right back in?
I mean, the game has completely changed. It's a whole, you know, new environment. It's a business aspect to it now. It's a social media, you know, frenzy that comes with the music industry now. It used to be a day and time where you could physically go touch your fans and do an autograph signing and, you know, get to know your fans personally when you went to their city. Now you know your fans overnight by the push of a button on your phone or a laptop. So it's just being caught up and up to speed. And a lot of times we have to understand that this is a young man's game. Even for myself to be in the game for as many years that I've been in, I have to step back sometimes and allow the youngsters to dictate the platform, because it's a youngster's game. It's always been that. When I mastered the game, I was young, and now that I'm getting a little older, I learned how to step back and to play my role and play my position. So for someone to be gone for so many years and to come back home, you have to really analyze and see what your position is. It may not be in front of the mic. It may be producing. It may be discovering somebody else or getting into the tech world or finding something that may even be, you know, a little bit more beneficial for you as opposed to rapping and making music.
You know, another thing, Weldon, that people talk a lot about is, yeah, it's hard to get a job, get back on your feet that way, but it's also hard to reconnect with your family. Criminologists and people who study this say that you need to be able to maintain contacts with family members while you're behind bars. That's really, really important for your reentry process later on. Was that difficult for you?
Yeah, it was difficult, especially in the federal system. They ship you all over the country. You could be from California, you end up in New York.
Yeah.
They give you like a few hundred minutes a month, and that's it.
You know, when we were talking yesterday, your fiance mentioned to me, I thought this was a really interesting point, that it's not just difficult for the person who comes out, it's tough for the family too to readjust. And what kind of resources are provided for families who are trying to adjust to having this person reenter their life?
None that I know of.
Yeah, he's telling the truth. I got homeboys that was locked up for 20 plus years and they out. And the first thing they said is they were scared to try to go get a job because they know that they have to say that they were locked up for 20 some years. And then they don't know what to go to next. So it's like hearing these great suggestions. And this story right here is a great segue for me to help out some of my homeboys that's on the streets right now that really are afraid to try to get a job because they don't want to be discriminated.
How are your kids doing, Weldon?
Oh, they're doing good.
Yeah?
I mean, there's some challenges. Like my oldest son, you know, he's suffered from depression, this whole experience. I mean, we got raided. He got guns pointed in his face. He was like 7 years old. This whole thing was just crazy. Like they treated me like I was like a terrorist or something over some marijuana.
Snoop, talk to us a little bit about the Youth Football League. We're talking about kids, we're talking about Weldon's kids. You want to get these guys young. Tell me about how you came up with the idea and why it's important to you.
Well, what I did 13 years ago, I wanted to bring something back to the inner cities. So I decided to create the Snoop Youth Football League. And I donated, you know, my time, my money, just so I could provide like an after school program. Because I remember growing up in my era, we had after school programs and things that would prevent us from joining gangs or doing things that were negative. And I just wasn't seeing that anymore. And I wanted to be one to be a doer as opposed to a talker. So I went and did it. I made it happen. I got some ex-gang members to get with me and become coaches and rehabilitate their neighborhoods and help these kids out and show them the right way from someone who did it the wrong way. And we went into different neighborhoods where we wasn't supposed to go, but through football, we forged a peace relationship. And we sent kids to high school. We sent kids to college for the first time in their family. We got 7 kids in the NFL. We got 5 in the combine this year. So we're doing great things, from a dream of mine to want to just put something back into the community out of my own pocket, not asking for no grants or no help or no push from nobody, but just saying, since I'm able and I'm blessed, it's my job to bless those who need to be blessed, and the kids needed it. So I gave it to them.
Mark, I always hear criminal justice and criminal justice reform kind of pigeonholed as a liberal issue. That's a liberal, progressive thing. Republicans do their thing, Democrats do their thing. But I've known you a few years. You're not a very liberal guy, but you care a lot about this issue.
You don't know me that well.
Why do conservatives care about this issue?
Yeah, and I think as I said earlier, it's been a bipartisan mess that created this. From, you go back to Reagan, to Bush, to Clinton, they've all done their part in it. And so it's something that both parties need to fix together. But as far as the criminal justice reform movement, it all started here, as you know, Vikrant. You were with Texas Public Policy Forum and Right on Crime. It's their 10th anniversary. And in 2007, Governor Rick Perry, they passed some meaningful reforms in the criminal justice system that started to reduce the number of people in prison. And over time, made it safer, saved money, saved billions of dollars, closing down prisons, giving people hope. Other states have done it. So it's close to 3 dozen states now have done some types of reforms. And it's been both blue and red states, but in a lot of ways, This is an issue that everybody needs to work on together. There are very few issues in our country anyone will work on together anymore. And it started in the states, really, because the states are responsible for their own budgets. They can't keep kicking the can down the road. They can't keep printing money and doing the same things that are destroying lives and wasting money and making us less safe like we do at the federal system level. And what they did was, over time, to reduce the size of their incarcerated in their states. That reduced crime rates, and it also reduced incarceration rates. And this is one of those issues that once people get involved and look at it, whether you're, you know, I don't care if you're Democrat, Republican, Independent, it doesn't matter, liberal, progressive, conservative, evangelical, there's something for everybody here from the beginning of the process to the end, whatever you believe in. If you believe in justice, if you believe in fairness, if you believe in redemption, you believe in people coming together, it's all good stuff. So the reality is that it's been a left and right problem that's been created, and we're seeing it being fixed that way. And it's an issue that, you know, we at Koch feel passionate about and have for many years. And it goes back to, for us, trying to bring people together and groups together to remove these barriers to opportunity that exist. And the criminal justice system is a huge barrier to opportunity, particularly if you're poor, particularly if you're uneducated. That's what, in my experience, the people mostly who end up in prison and having their lives ruined. And it goes back to what Frederick Douglass said, that we unite with anyone to do good and unite with no one to do harm. And so at the end of the day, whether it's a Republican or a Democrat, it really doesn't matter. If they want to do something good, they want to help their people and help their state and save a lot of money that they can then use on other things like education and drug treatment and roads and things like that, criminal justice reform is the place to go.
You mentioned these Texas reforms. I will say I'm from Texas, and I'm very, very proud of them. People are a bit surprised that Texas has been a leader in this area, but it has been. And what Texas basically tried to do, I heard this great line from a state representative who said, listen, prisons are for people you're scared of, not people you're mad at.
The other thing I'd say, interrupt, is that I've heard that line, and then I've also heard the other line, because you always hear about you're soft on crime, you're tough on crime. That's all nonsense. We need to be smart on crime and soft on taxpayers.
I have a suggestion.
Yeah.
I have a suggestion for Texas and a couple other states. Legalize. And I'll back that up by saying this. I look at Denver, Colorado, when the moment they decided to legalize, and I look at where they are now. It was so many jobs given out, it was so many opportunities, it was homelessness removed, and they took the money and they put it back into the educational system. And it's working. It's not taking money and putting it to penitentiary systems, but putting it to the education system. So it's like their program is working. It's peaceful. It's nice. It's less crime. And when you go to Denver, Colorado, it's like tranquility. So I'm just putting that in the air. So maybe Texas can, you know, breathe on that.
Well, you know, Weldon, Snoop is talking about the kind of thing that this state representative was talking to me about when he said there's a difference between people you're scared of and people you're mad at. When you were behind bars, you probably saw some people who you thought, okay, that guy needs to be here. He's a bad dude. You must have seen some people who just didn't need to be there.
Yeah, I would say the majority of people I felt that about. I mean, there's a few people. You've seen some youngsters in there, 18 years old with 40-year sentences. Like they're not even grown yet, and you're giving them 40 years.
You were telling me a story yesterday about somebody you met behind bars who you're trying to help get out because his situation is similar to yours in some ways. Can you tell us a bit about him?
Yeah, his name's,
you can say his name.
His name's Luke Scarmazzo. He ran a medical marijuana dispensary in Modesto, California. He and his co-defendant were indicted under the Bush administration and given 22 years for following state law. I helped draft a petition to Obama. One of them got it, the other one didn't. So I was kind of upset with that because they have the exact same case. One got out, one didn't. So I'm still fighting for my buddy, trying to get him out. 22 years for something that's legal? No, in most states.
That's G.
Mark, I mentioned in your intro that you actually had a college part-time job working inside a prison, Worcester County.
Worcester, get it right, man.
I'm not from Massachusetts. I'm not a Patriots fan.
That's your loss. I can't help you there.
Oh, boy, that split the audience more than anything. Talk to us a bit about your reflections from having had that job back in those days. Yeah, what did you see?
Yeah, no, so that it was back in the early 80s. I worked in a prison, and it was an eye-opening experience, to say the least. It was, a time where I was able to catch up with a number of people I grew up with, went to the same schools, high school, junior high, grew up in the same neighborhoods who I'd lost track of. And I saw them, they were in prison, not working there, they were living there. And these were kids, same circumstances as me. I come from a working class background. And the only thing I could tell was different from me from them, my parents made me do all these things I didn't want to do, like go to school, go to church, work, and all that. And their parents weren't as present maybe in their lives. I don't know. It's not necessarily the parents' fault, but I was really lucky because there are a lot of things I did. If I had gotten caught and got in trouble, my life would have been ruined because we didn't have any money. And that's what happens in our system. So it was for me, at an early age, this is the start of the war on drugs, and a lot of these guys were drug addicts who, once they were drug addicted, did the dumb things that addicts do to keep, you know, their addiction fed, and then they get more and more into the whole cycle, get into prison. Once they can't, once they're out, they can't get jobs, go back in. And so what it taught me at an early age was this is a messed up system. What are we doing here? These people are people that need jobs, they need opportunity, probably need drug treatment. And then we let them out of prison, and then they can't get jobs. So they pay their debt to society. We accept that payment, i.e. we make them serve their time, but we never forgive the debt. And as Weldon said, it's the tattoo on your forehead, the scarlet letter F. So to me, that never made sense. Like I said, it's what Bryan Stevenson, I'm sure a lot of you in the crowd know who Bryan Stevenson is. He's one of my heroes. And he talks about how you have to be proximate to an issue before you'll care about it and try to fix it. Well, I was proximate from a young age because of that. And so that's why I've been involved in this for a long time. I had another job in Worcester where I was a janitor at a plastics factory, and they would augment the crew every day with a bunch of guys from work release. So it was kind of an early reentry program, if you will. And there were about 8 to 10 of them, and I'd say eight out of the 10 guys were great guys. Two of them were kind of jerks, but that's the normal distribution in society, whether in prison or not, I figure. But it just taught me that the people that go in, you know, a lot of people go in over nothing, and then other people do some bad things, but they're all coming out. So trying to help them be better and get better was an important thing. And that's what's been, you know, really, I'd say, so devastating the last 20 or 30 years, the way we've treated people, who a lot of them, you know, I'm not excusing criminal behavior, but man, we always talk about giving people second chances. A lot of these people never had a first chance. So that's what I learned.
I want to ask you another thing, Mark, and this actually comes from Snoop. In the video, there's a moment where Snoop makes a really interesting observation. I'm going to quote him. Snoop says, "At the end of the day, if you're not represented the right way, you're not going to make the right decision."
Yeah.
That's an interesting point.
He's spot on. I'm glad Snoop's a rapper, not a lawyer, because he'd probably take my job away. But he's spot on in the sense that if you look at the criminal justice system, there's so many things that need to be fixed, from the laws that are passed to the power of prosecutors. But you go to the middle, right before you're actually charged or you have to plead guilty or you go into trial, the key is having a lawyer. And the beauty of our system, there's a lot of flaws, but the beauty of our system, the Bill of Rights, 40% of it deal with criminal justice issues. If you look at the 4th, 5th, 6th, and 8th Amendment, and the key to unlocking those, when the government, you're standing up against the awesome power of the government, and they're trying to take away your life, liberty, property, and pursuit of happiness, the only thing to keep you from, you know, falling right into that with no chance is a lawyer. And the Founding Fathers, who got a lot of things wrong, but they nailed this one. And so the 6th Amendment says you must have a lawyer. And that's a great thing. But as Snoop pointed out, the reality of that, it doesn't happen. At the federal level, it happens pretty much, but there's no money in a lot of our states for anything. If you can't fund schools, it's really hard to make an argument to the public that we need to fund criminal defense lawyers, even though the Constitution requires it. And then case law in the Supreme Court, the Gideon case, says if you can't afford a lawyer, the state must pay for it. That isn't happening. So what happens in our system is, again, and this goes back to what I was just talking about, what I saw growing up and what Snoop saw and what Weldon experienced, people get picked up. A lot of them don't have resources. Weldon at least had good lawyers, as I understand it. But most of them don't. And they end up pleading guilty to something, not always understanding what's going on or fully understanding the implications, and their lives are ruined. And it's my opinion that there is an inherent conflict when you've got the government, which is obligated, required under the Bill of Rights. This is a natural right. This is not a right government can take away from you without due process. You have a fundamental right to a lawyer when you're charged with a crime. That same government isn't doing that, but yet they're prosecuting you and trying to railroad you. And that's an inherent mm-hmm. conflict. And to me, it's a constitutional crisis. No one else, I don't know, seems to be that concerned about it, but I am. And it seems more and more we're hearing more about it, which is good. So it's good people like Snoop are talking about it. Because if you don't have a lawyer, the system is brutal. We have a two-tier justice system. If you're wealthy and connected, you're going to be fined. Brian Stevenson talks about our system treats the rich and guilty much better than it treats the poor and innocent. So if you don't have a lawyer, you're hosed from beginning to end. And so that is the key. And if it's something that no one's really talking about, there was a lawsuit filed 2 weeks ago in Missouri by the ACLU against the state of Missouri and their public defender system because they're not giving these people adequate time to prepare or any resources. So it's a big deal. It's a big issue. And I'm glad, like I said, Snoop called attention to it. And hopefully people in the audience here will start to call attention to it and start to ask questions in their states and in their counties. Why aren't we funding criminal defense lawyers? You believe in the rule of law? You believe in the Constitution? The Constitution says it has to happen.
We got some questions from the audience. I'm going to ask a few of these. Weldon, this question was directed at you. Someone wants to know, while you were in prison, what was the common factor behind all the people behind bars?
What do you mean?
What did they all have in common? Why was there anything that they all had in common?
Just the fact that we're all convicted and sitting in prison, but no, it was pretty diverse.
People are pretty different back there. Another person wanted me to ask you how you've talked to your kids about your time behind bars. Have you told them this was because I sold marijuana? What kinds of questions have they asked? They're curious about that.
Well, they kind of knew my story because my case was always in the media.
Yeah.
So they kind of were familiar with it and they experienced all of it. My sons were at my trial, sentencing.
Snoop, there's a question for you, and it's really broad, but I think it's interesting. Someone asks, as an artist, how do you heal?
Oh, wow. Sometimes through listening to music, smoking a blunt. That's the best healing process.
Mark, I think I'm going to direct this question to you. Somebody is curious about the fact that we have a new administration in Washington. Our new attorney general, they ask in particular, Jeff Sessions, has been skeptical of some of the things we've talked about today. And they want to know about what you see politically in the future for criminal justice reform.
Well, as I started out earlier, that I think that the good news is criminal justice reform is not dead. It's still thriving, particularly at the state level. And at the state level, it's important because 90% of the people in the system are in the states. But the federal system, it's important to reform that for a lot of reasons, not the least of which they're the ones that started these policies that the states followed that have now corrected because they don't work. Mm-hmm. And so at the federal level, there were some good bills the last few years, and as usual, politics got in the way. And what are the prospects now? I'd say that the prospects are kind of wait and see. I would have said that if Hillary Clinton was president. I think that whoever the president was, there's so many other issues, whether it's, you know, the infrastructure or tax issues or jobs or whatever else, that's going to be the main focus. And no disrespect to Secretary Clinton, but, you know, her words in the campaign never matched up with her actions of her and her husband when they were in, you know, public positions. They weren't very good on these issues either with the 94 crime bill, if anyone remembers that.
Three strikes.
Yeah. So... Exactly. And then taking away all the Pell Grants.
Still in the penitentiary behind them three strikes.
And so that's why these reforms need to happen at the federal level and the state level. These whole three strikes laws and everything else are just overly punitive. They don't keep people safer. They don't make communities safer. It creates a lot of recidivism issues, hurts communities. It ends up putting law enforcement more and more in danger. None of it's good. So I think at the federal level, here's my point of view. I think the same bills that were pending the last couple of years will be resubmitted, talked to some Republicans in the House and the Senate and some Democrats who all agree on that. And I think that we're just going to wait and see what happens if there's an opportunity. Every president needs wins. It's just the way it is. This president's going to need some wins. This is an issue. If he wants to help people, and he talked about helping people, African Americans and Latinos, this is something to show to reach out to them that he really does care. And once he understands what's in these bills, I'm confident that there's no way anybody reasonable would oppose them. Because all we're talking about is keeping some people out of the system who
you
aren't
violent.
You just
said nobody reasonable. That dude ain't reasonable.
What did he say? He said no one reasonable.
But
yeah.
Good point. Anyway, Here, there are people in his administration who will read it, and
there you go. That sounds much better.
In particular, Rick Perry again, Mike Pence, they've done reforms. I've got some friends who are working in there as well as aides who are very passionate about these issues, and I'm still optimistic it's going to happen, and I'm not optimistic about much coming out of D.C., but I think that even Jeff Sessions, when he's now in charge of the entire Department of Justice budget, and he starts to look at how much is spent on incarcerating people and who we're incarcerating for how long and what the hard dollar costs, and more importantly, the societal costs overall, I think it's going to change. We'll see. We're going to keep pushing. We're just going to keep grinding away. If you don't keep grinding away, nothing happens. So we're not going away. I hope you all don't either. I hope you keep pushing at it, talking to whoever, whatever state you're from. If it's Texas, actually, one of your senators, John Cornyn, is great on these issues. Your other senator is not. And that's too bad. He used to be. And so hopefully he can get there again.
I actually kind of want to follow up on what Snoop asked about, well, what he joked about, saying nobody reasonable. Look, we're all on stage. There's conservatives, there's liberals, there's libertarians, black, white, Indian American. That's me. Everybody agrees on these issues.
Yeah.
Who is the opposition exactly? Disagrees?
I think at the state level, I don't know that there is. We're seeing it in every state. I don't know, I probably mentioned this. Kentucky and Michigan passed reforms last week.
Yeah.
And they're, you know, they have Republican governors. You had Maryland got rid of their mandatory minimums last year, Republican governor. So I think at the federal level, look, the federal system, it's a time warp. It's on tape delay. So I often say we're dealing with these rules and laws that were put in the 80s and 90s, and we're trying to convince the people that put them in the 80s and 90s to change them, and they're all in their 80s and 90s. And look, my mom's real old. It's tough for her to change her ways. Like, you know, when they change the time of Jeopardy, she get all messed up on. She can't adjust it. I think that's part of what we're dealing with. And we saw last year, it was really, in my opinion, unfortunate in the Senate where a few people shut it down because of election year politics. And I don't know that anybody that's against it. I do know that there are people who don't agree necessarily on all the reforms, and that's fine, but there's a lot we do agree on. So if you're sentencing reform issues, you have a concern about, well, let's look at prison reform. Prison reform meaning the people in prison, we need to make them better. We need to make them so when they come out, they don't hurt people. They come out better than they went in. So they need educational training, they need vocational training, some spiritual training, something to make them more productive when they get out. There's back-end relief. You talked about collateral consequences. There are 50,000 collateral consequences in this country to criminal convictions. That's insane. And they keep you beyond jobs, housing, loans, you name it. You can't be with your family sometimes. It's crazy. So we need to ratchet down all of those things. I think there's enough good that people can agree on, and people do agree on. But at the federal level, it's always going to be different. I mean, everyone's seeing that here today. But I do think in time, it's just going to happen because it makes sense.
It's going to happen because you got to understand that the old school cats that you're talking about, they had their run. And now that the youngsters are in office or being, you know, trained to become in office, they was raised off of this. So by them being raised off of this, they got the same spirit that we had. And they're going to push for what's right. And they're going to change the game and make it happen for the benefit of the better.
That's right. Yeah. And you look at the Senate, to Snoop's point, you look in the Senate, so you've got like Cory Booker, who is phenomenal on these issues. You've got Mike Lee, you know, who's phenomenal on these issues. Rand Paul. I mean, there's a lot of just younger people coming up both in the House and the Senate, and it's, you all are way young in this crowd. I'm like the oldest guy here. But everybody here, I mean, when people hear like about Weldon's case that someone went to prison 55 years because he sold marijuana and had a gun and didn't use it and he owned the gun legally, that's insane. I mean, you talked about, if he was one state east in Colorado, you'd been an entrepreneur instead of a felon. I mean, it's crazy.
I've talked about a lot of criminal justice and legal theories up here today. There's another one I want to bring up. It's called swift and certain consequences. And the idea behind this theory is that even if you think somebody's doing something wrong, you don't have to give an extremely harsh punishment like the 55-year sentence that you got. You just want to get them quickly at a low-level punishment, and then let them get back to living their lives. And Snoop, I'm going to direct this question to you because I saw this really interesting interview that you did with Arsenio Hall 20 years ago, and you talked about this probation officer that you had who, instead of sending you into the penitentiary, would just send you to county real briefly, and you said that he kind of knocked some sense into you, and you really appreciated him.
Yeah, he actually saved my life because the case that I had to get me probation was I had a selling cocaine case. And from that, I took a deal for joint suspension, which meant that I would get a certain amount of time, but when I got out, I would be on probation for 3 years, but if I violate, I go to the penitentiary for 5 years. So I had a toothache and I didn't have no money or prescription or nothing, so my auntie gave me a codeine or something. So I took it and I ended up having a dirty test. And my test was dirty and I wasn't supposed to be around no drugs. So my probation officer, he told me, he said, I see you trying to do the right thing. Instead of me sending you to the penitentiary, I'm gonna send you to the county for 4 months. And when you get out, if you do good by me, I'll let you off of probation. So when I went for those 4 months and I got out, I got a record deal and I became a rapper and things started to happen for me. And then he took me off of probation and here you have it right now.
Am I pronouncing his name right, David Dwoskin?
Yeah, Mr. Dwoskin.
Mr. Dwoskin.
Yes, sir.
Mark, there's something that hasn't come up today that I want to talk about. There are a lot of people behind bars who are struggling with mental illness issues.
Yeah.
What are we supposed to do about that crowd? Because I don't get the impression that prison is the best place for them.
No, it's not. I think the number is there's 10 times the number of people with mental illness in prisons than there are in mental institutions or mental hospitals. Yeah, that's the problem in our society. What we're, I was on a panel a couple of years ago with Tom Dart, who's the sheriff of Cook County in Chicago, and he said that in his view, the criminal justice system is neither. I'm not dealing with criminals, and there is no justice. We're warehousing people. He said he's one of the largest distributors of pharmaceuticals in the country. Most of them have mental illnesses. They're warehoused and they're kept in prison either because. In the jail until trial because they can't afford bail. They have nowhere to go. And they end up spending more time sometimes incarcerated waiting for their case to be even heard is longer than their sentence would have been. And that gets back to, in my opinion, how we've misused our criminal justice system and it hasn't made us safer. And, you know, after those really awful, horrific shootings in Dallas of the police officers last July, the former chief of police of Dallas talked about how what's happened in our system is we've decided to treat everything criminal and have law enforcement go after it. So whether it's, you know, mental illness issues, poverty issues, drug addiction issues, which is a public health issue, let the police deal with it. And it creates constant strife, makes the community, you know, makes the communities not really feel that great about being targeted as they might feel over these, what they see as ticky-tack issues sometimes. And it doesn't make us safer. So if you abuse that system, we've used so much money on the criminal justice system and incarcerating people without making it safer. We don't have funds for mental health treatment and those types of issues. Prison's a terrible place. I mean, I don't have to tell you that. I mean, I've worked in them. And no one, it's rare that someone comes out better than they went in. And someone with a mental illness, it's just, I mean, it's, you talk about Eighth Amendment cruel and unusual, it's crazy to put someone who has a mental illness in prison. It's the worst thing that could happen to him.
I did my brother like that, my little brother. He went to jail when he was like 17 and he was a juvenile and they had him in there until he was 25. And he had a couple of mental issues and they started giving him Thorazine. I think that's the name of it. And we would go visit him and he would just get slower and slower. And it was got to a point to where he couldn't even communicate with us no more. And it was nothing that we could say or do. This is what he was prescribed. They was giving him this medicine to calm him down for him having fights in there. And there's nothing that we could do to this day. So I'm up here in many ways, affected in so many ways. That's why I'm here today, not just, you know, to try to use my voice, but it's personal to me. Because I feel like it's so many people that are affected when they're incarcerated, whether it's the right way, the wrong way, however you want to put it. And I'm just here to bring some light to the situation. That's why I'm here.
So the hope would be if we could shrink the size of our criminal justice system and the incarceration rates, and then we could redirect those resources and have resources so people who have mental illnesses could be helped and people could have good schools in their communities and these kids would get educations and not end up in prison. These are all the things that will happen with criminal justice reform as it makes us safer and makes everybody safer, including law enforcement and the community. So that's the goal, because the mental health issue is huge. And it has to be fixed as well.
Weldon, when you were inside, Did they provide resources for people who had drug addiction, mental health problems, even just educational, you know, vocational training? What was given to inmates?
Yeah, they had some resources. Most of the classes are inmate taught, so a lot of people don't attend those classes. But they provide some resources.
Yeah.
Not enough, of course.
Yeah.
Some of the things that we've seen, talking about a lot of things that need to change at the federal level, there's a lot of innovative public-private partnerships, whatever you want to call it, in, particularly in reentry. And there's a lot of education programs going on that are really effective, I think, as well. One is the Bard Prison Initiative. It basically brings that college curriculum inside the state penitentiary. They have a world-class debate team that beat Harvard a couple of years ago. And so these people are getting an education who never had a chance at an education. They come out, they're able to get jobs and be productive members of society. There's also some other organizations like Defy Ventures, which is a private organization that goes into a 501c3 that goes into prisons and teaches inmates entrepreneurial skills. And their whole thing is transform the hustle. Because a lot of people who get caught up in prison in the drug trade, they know markets. They know market segmentation. They're pretty sharp. They're entrepreneurial. So trying to transform that and get it into a more productive place. And this group, Defy Ventures, has ended up having numbers of people start their own businesses when they come out of prison. And the recidivism rate nationally is somewhere, it goes between 50 and 70%. Defy Ventures, 3.2% recidivism rate. Bard College, 1.2% recidivism rate. None of this is rocket science. None of it's even political science, which was my major. It's just common sense. If someone has an education, someone who's like what Snoop's doing, which is so exemplary with that football league, just something for kids to do, someone caring about them that they don't want to disappoint, they get an education, they get an opportunity and a job, they're probably going to stay out of the system. And if that doesn't happen, it's even more important they have that once they're in. And that's on all of us to help them succeed when they get out, in my opinion. So.
You know, I really wanted to end on a positive note, and I think that's a pretty good positive note to end on. Good things are happening. Thank you all so much for joining us today. Thank you to our panelists.